Good afternoon, one and all. Welcome to DT Studio. I am Shaila, lecturer from SJ Government Polytechnic, Bengaluru. So in the last class, we have discussed about two of the opto semiconductor devices. They are LED, and also we have discussed about opto isolator, or also called as opto coupler. So today we'll discuss about some more opto semiconductor devices. So that is, first we'll discuss about what is laser, and we'll also see the working and some of the features of the one more device, which is maser. So let us begin with laser. So laser stands for light amplification by stimulated emission of radiation. So we'll understand what is the meaning of stimulated emission. So before that, so this laser is a device which generates a light, or what we have seen, the LED. It is very much similar to LED. So it generates a light, or it converts the electrical energy into light. So what is the difference between the LED and a laser is, so there, in case of LED, whatever the radiation we see, it is because of spontaneous emission of electrons. So we have discussed about the working of LED. So due to the recombination, so whatever the energy lost by the electrons while jumping from the conduction band to the valence band, so we'll emit as the light energy, which appears in the form of the photons, which are being emitted from the surface. So that was about LED. So here the laser is the same thing, which converts a electrical signal to light, but instead of the emission, which is because of spontaneous emission, here we see it is a stimulated emission in case of laser diode. So we'll understand what is that stimulated emission. So how do we define a laser? It is an optoelectronic device that generates an intense or a very narrow beam of single color light. So single color light is having a single wavelength, what we call it as monochromatic light, and it is a very high intense and a very narrow beam of light. So unlike your LED, where we see the light which is so illuminated, so irrespective of that, so here what you have the LED, so the laser diode which emits a light is a monochromatic, which is a single color, and it is very intensive. That is very a narrow beam of light is emitted by laser diode. So this is obtained, the very high intense or a narrow beam of light is obtained because of a process what we call it as amplifying the photons. So with the colliding with the excited atoms. So whenever these emitted photons, so we have seen in case of LED, whenever these emitted photons, so they react with the excited molecules or atoms, because of this collision, so it leads to emission of some more photons. So this is what we call it as generating the increased number of photons because of amplification, or what we call it as multiplication. So in case of laser diode, because of this phenomenon, we see a very high intensity narrow beam of light is emitted from a laser diode because of a amplification of a photons. Why is this possible? Because of interacting with the excited atoms, which leads to a generation of some more photons. So that is about the laser diode. So this laser diode, so the laser can be of the four types, depending on what type of lasing medium is used. So depending on whether it is a gas, solid, or it is a semiconductor. So depending on that, so we have different types of laser, depending on the laser lasing medium which is used. So lasing medium is nothing but where the spontaneous or a stimulated emission of a radiation takes place, is where we call it as a medium. So depending on this, the medium, we have a different lasers. So whatever we have discussing is a diode, which is nothing but a laser, which is made up of a semiconductor device. So hence we say it is a laser diode. And this uses a PN junction to emit a coherent light. So what is the meaning of coherent light? So all the light waves emitted will travel with the same frequency, and they are in phase. So what does it mean? In phases, they have their peaks which are lined up. They are traveling together. That is the meaning. So whatever the emit the light, so which is emitted from the laser diode is a coherent light in which all the waves are at the same frequency and phase. So meaning that they are traveling together, which are the similar wavelength, and they are generated at the same frequency. So hence we see that this laser diode is a PN junction semiconductor device, so which is very much similar to LED, but whatever the light emitted is, we say it is a coherent light. So unlike your LED, there we say it is a non-coherent light, but in case of the laser diode, we say it is a, the light emitted by a laser diode is a coherent light. So looking at the symbol of the laser diode, where the symbol, it is same as that of the LED, where they having the two terminals, the cathode connected to n-type semiconductor, and the anode, which is a positive electrode, connected to the p-type semiconductor. So with the two arrow marks, so indicating as if the light is emitted from the device. So this is a symbol which represents a laser diode, and these are the some of the diagram shown here. So where with this openings, we see that a narrow beam of light is emitted from the laser diode. So as we told, so the laser which is manufactured, we have a different types of a laser depending on what type of lasing medium which is used. What is a lasing medium? Where the stimulated and the spontaneous emission of radiation takes place. So depending on that, we have a gas, the solid state, even we have a liquid laser. So out of this, what we are discussing is a laser diode, which it is made up of a semiconductor, which is a PN junction. Coming to the construction of a laser diode, so it has got a p-type layer, so which is the silicon or the intrinsic semiconductor, which is doped with a so trivalent impurity atoms, which forms a p-type layer, and we have a n-type layer where the intrinsic semiconductor, which is doped with the pentavalent impurity atoms, it forms a n layer. So there we have a p-n junction which is formed between the p-type and the n-type layer. So whatever we see across a p-n junction is a depletion region, the meaning that it is depleted of majority charge carriers, and we see, so that is what we, hence we call that as a depletion region. And we have a connecting the leads, which has the anode and the cathode, the anode which is connected to a p-type and the cathode connected to a n-type. So if you look at this, so one side of a laser diode is kept very highly reflective. So this the end of the diode is kept highly reflective, so another end is made partially reflective. So this is done in order to achieve what we call it as stimulated emission. So when you look at the meaning or the laser, it stands light amplification by stimulated emission of radiation. So it involves the two terminologies. What is that? Light amplification, so where we are going to obtain the multiplication or amplification of a light by what process? Stimulated emission of radiation. So in order to achieve that stimulated emission of radiation, so the construction is made such a that, so the surfaces on one end of a diode is kept highly reflective to the photon, so or what we call it as the light particles, and another is end is made the partially reflective. So though through this partially reflective end, we see that the light, the laser light is emitted from the diode. So with this partially reflective end, we see that a very intense narrow beam of light is emitted from this partially reflective end. So while understanding the construction, so working, we'll understand better why the one end is made very highly reflective and another is made partially reflective. So this is about the construction of a laser diode. So looking at this construction, as we told, it is a two layers of a semiconductor. So the semiconductor compound used here is a gallium arsenide. So and one end of a surface is kept highly reflective, and another surface is a partially reflective, which is opposite to that highly reflective surface. And the external leads provide the anode and a cathode connections for the laser diode. Now coming to the operation of laser diode. So this laser diode operates in mainly three steps. The one is energy absorption, and the second one is spontaneous emission, and the third one is what we call it as stimulated emission. So we'll see this. So if you recall the operation of LED, so where the phenomenon involves the energy absorption and the spontaneous emission. But in case of laser diode, along with these two steps, so we have one more step called as stimulated emission. So we'll understand what are these steps. So this first, if you look at this, the laser diode requires a biasing voltage. So hence this diode needs to be operated in a forward biasing in order to assist to generate the photons. So first, the laser diode is forward biased by an external voltage source. So because of this forward biasing of the PN junction, or what we call it as the laser diode, so what happens to electrons? The free electrons, which are the majority charge carriers in N-type semiconductor, and the holes, which are the majority charge carriers in a P-type semiconductor, they start drifting because of the opposite polarity of the applied voltage. They start moving. So hence, whenever they start crossing the junction, the PN junction, so they recombine with the holes. The electrons will recombine with the hole. And what happens? So the free electrons, after recombination, they jump from the higher energy band to a lower energy band, releasing what we call it as energy. And that released energy appears in the form of a photon. So what we call it as spontaneous emission. So what is this? The energy absorption. So the electrons absorb energy and they transit to a higher energy level. They start drifting across a junction. So once when they cross, while they're crossing the junction, the recombination occurs between the electrons and the holes. So as an ordinary diode, so we have seen that. So while understanding the working of a PN junction diode, so whenever the electrons are swept across or through the junction, so their recombination takes place. So in case of your normal diodes, so this recombination, after the recombination, we see that the energy is emitted as in the form of a heat, whatever we see it is in the case of normal or ordinary diode. But in case of LED or the laser diode, so this energy which is lost by the electrons, so because of the jumping from the higher conduction band to the lower energy level, this lost energy from the electron appears as if the light or the photon is emitted from the surface. So this is what we call it as spontaneous emission. So till here, the working is same as that of LED, what we have discussed in LED. So if you look at the diagram, so this diagram explains what is the meaning of spontaneous emission. So if you look at this, so this is the higher energy level. So, and this is a lower energy level. This is a higher energy level and the lower energy level. So whenever the electrons, so which is at the higher energy level, so when they jump to a lower energy level, when the electron falls to a lower energy level, so the energy is going to appear as a emitted photon. What are the energy, amount of energy which is lost by the electron, so will appear as if the light photon is emitted from a surface. So that is what it is shown here. So as if the photon is emitting, so whenever the electrons fall from a higher energy level to a lower energy level. So this entire phenomenon is what we call it as spontaneous emission. So the emission or the emission of a photons due to the electrons fall from higher energy level to a lower energy level. So this is what the same thing what we have discussed in LED. So these emitted photons will appear as though the light is emitted from the surface. So what is the third step? We told it involves mainly the three steps. So we have seen what is energy absorption. It makes the electrons to go, takes the electrons to the higher energy level because of this energy absorption. And so they cannot, the electrons cannot stay in the excited state for a longer time. So hence what they'll do is they fall back to a lower energy, so which leads to what we call it as spontaneous emission. This released photon, what you have the photon which is emitted, so because of a spontaneous emission, it can strike an atom. So if you look at this, what is it? This is an existing photon, which is generated because of the electron fall from a higher energy to a lower energy. Okay, so this released photon, which is in what phenomena this is released? During spontaneous emission. So whatever the released photon during the spontaneous emission, so it can strike an atom. So this is going to strike an atom, so which causes another photon to be released. So if you look at this diagram, the second diagram, so we have one electron at a higher energy level. We have a one electron at a higher energy level. This is nothing but it has an excited atom. Though when this existing photon, whenever this strikes the excited atoms, so this makes the electron to jump to a lower energy level. So this electrons, the energy in the which is at the higher energy level, it jumps to a ground state, or what we call it as lower energy, releasing in what it happens, it releases a one more photon, so which is identical to that, so which is going to hit the excited atom. So hence what we see here, the two photons are released or generated from the surface due to a phenomenon of what we call it as stimulated emission. The spontaneous emission is because of the electrons at the higher energy level, so they cannot stay back at the excited condition for a longer time, so they jump to a lower state. What the phenomenon we call it as spontaneous emission. So what is the stimulated emission? So with a released photon, whenever the released photon, it strikes an atom, the excited atom, so it causes more and more electrons to jump to a lower band or a lower energy level, so which makes identical photons to be released. So this phenomenon is called as stimulated emission. So this photon, what it does is, it is going to, whenever it strikes an atom, so before the recombination time of this electrons, so these electrons will be pulled or will fall back to a lower energy state, so that it releases a one more identical photon, so which is identical to the existing photon. So in this way, so because of this stimulated emission phenomenon, we see more and more photons, so which are generated or which are emitted from the surface. So hence we say that more coherent photons from the laser diode than once emitted through the process of spontaneous emission. So as I told, with the spontaneous emission, whatever the number of photons so which are emitted, we see is less than what we are obtaining the photons from the stimulated emission. So we are going to obtain more and more coherent photons. What does it mean? So they are traveling with the same speed, or they have the same wavelength, and they are in phase. So hence we say that as a coherent photons are generated or emitted from the process of stimulated emission than with a spontaneous emission. So hence the laser involves both the process of spontaneous emission initially, then so thereby it has a one more process of stimulated emission. So in order to have the stimulated emission, so the construction of a diode is made in such a way that the photons which are emitted from this process, so needs to be trapped in the junction. It should not go out, it should not be emitted out of the surface. So whatever the photons we see which are emitted from this process, they should be trapped so that it further gives out the stimulated emission. So this is about the stimulated emission of a lasing, what we call it as lasing action. Now, so as we told, the construction is made in such a way that, so one, the side of the diode is made partially reflective, so that the photons which are released from the spontaneous emission are trapped in the p-n junction until their concentration reaches a value called as threshold value. So that is what I told. So whatever the amount of photons so which are released by the spontaneous emission, so they are not allowed to escape. So instead, what it is done, they are trapped in the p-n junction such that they give rise to more number of photons, and they undergo multiple reflections, striking some more atoms, giving some more photons. So these trapped photons until their concentration reaches a value called as threshold value. That is a maximum, the capacity of the where the junction can the photons can be trapped. So these trapped photons, they stimulate the excited electrons to recombine with holes. So before their recombination time, so they start before they recombine. So they are stimulated. The excited atoms are stimulated to recombine so that it gives rise to more photons. So what happens? This results in the release of more photons. So that are in exact phase with the initial photons. So whatever we see that the output gets amplified. So whatever the initially generated photons because of spontaneous emission, so which gives rise to more number of photons because of stimulated emission. Hence, we say that we are going to get the amplified output because of more photons which are generated because of a stimulated emission process. So once the photon concentration, whatever the amount of the photons which are trapped in the p-n junction, so once the concentration, when it goes above the threshold value, so they start escaping from the partially reflecting end, not that the highly reflective end. So this highly reflective end is kept in order to obtain a higher amplification of the photon generation. So whatever we see, the other opposite end, which is a partially reflecting surface. So through this surface, whenever the concentration of photons, the trapped photons, when it goes above the threshold value, they escape from this surface. So whatever we see is a bright monochromatic, the coherent light, so which is coming out of a laser diode. So if you look at that, the laser light, we see the narrow opening through one end of a device. So that narrow opening, through that narrow opening, so we see that, so a light, a very high intensive, a narrow beam of light is emitting from a device, through that a narrow opening from the one end of a device. So this is about the working of the laser diode, where we see that it involves the energy absorption, the spontaneous emission, and the stimulated emission. So what is the difference between the LED and the laser diode? So in case of LED, we see that, so we have an energy absorption and the spontaneous emission. But in case of laser diode, along with these two, we have the one more process called as stimulated emission. So what is this? Whatever the amount of photons, so which are generated by the spontaneous emission, they strike the excited atoms, giving rise to a more number of photons, or what we call it as, we are going to obtain the amplified photons or a multiplication of a photon number. So hence we see that, so more photons which are generated, so and these photons, they come out, they give out as the coherent light coming out of a laser diode. So looking at this diagram, so what is that? The P layer and the N layer, so which is separated by a p-n junction, which is shown with the blue region. So whenever we apply the voltage across anode and cathode, so whenever we apply a forward voltage, so between the positive and the negative, or the anode and the cathode, so we see that the electrons start drifting towards the positive terminal of a supply. So the electrons will start drifting towards the positive terminal of supply, and while crossing a junction, they recombine with holes. So the electrons recombine with holes. So during the recombination, so the electrons, so they lose the energy, they fall from higher energy level to a lower energy level. So during this process, so the energy lost by the electron will appear as though a photon is emitted from the diode. So this process we call it as spontaneous emission. And whatever the amount of photons, so which are generated because of this spontaneous emission, are trapped inside this region. What we see it is across a p-n junction region. And so these trapped the photons, so they are trapped inside the p-n junction till it reaches a concentration of a threshold. So once they reach a threshold concentration, so they are escaped out of a a partially reflective surface, a narrow opening which is provided at the laser diode. So they are coming out of the opening or a narrow beam as if a very high intensity, the monochromatic coherent light is emitted from a diode. And whatever the photons which are generated by the spontaneous emission, so which strikes some more electrons which are in the excited state and makes them to jump to a lower energy and releasing what we say a identical photon to that of the original photon which is striking the excited atom. So hence we see that, so in case of your spontaneous emission, we see for every electron jumping, falling from a higher energy to a lower energy level, we see one photon generated out of the surface in case of LED. So when it goes for a stimulated emission, so we see that for every one photon which is generated in the spontaneous emission, it gives out what we say it is two or more photons which is emitting from the surface. So hence we see that in case of a laser diode, so the light, so which is coming out of the device is having a coherent, where all the light waves or the photons which are generated, so will travel in the same with the same wavelength and a frequency, they are in phase. So what are the movement of a photons, so which are generated across a p-n junction, so the cavity which is maintained, we call it as a resonating cavity, so where it starts moving back and forth, what we call it as they start reflecting at the highly reflective surface. So whenever they start reflecting, they strike some more excited atoms, releasing some more photons. So each photon which is produced in this process is what we identical to other photons. So hence we say that whatever the light coming out of a laser is a monochromatic or a coherent light. So because of this stimulated emission of a radiation, so whatever the light we see, so coming out of the laser diode is having a single wavelength, very highly intense light which is emerging from the laser diode. So whatever the threshold level of a current is very important in case of laser diode. So the lasing action, or what we call it as a stimulated emission of a radiation, takes place only when the laser diode current reaches a level called as threshold level. So till below the threshold level, so it acts as if a normal LED. So above the threshold level, so it undergoes a amplification of photons, hence giving out a narrow beam of light. So for the laser diode, so this threshold value of a current is very important, above which the lasing action takes place, and below the threshold level of current, so it essentially behaves as a normal LED, so which emits a incoherent light. So one of the important characteristics of a laser is what we say it is a threshold level. So the lasing action, what is that, the stimulated emission of a radiation, that will not take place until a threshold level of current is applied, or it requires always a minimum power to be applied in order to take place a lasing action. So this is about the working of a laser diode, how the laser diode is operated in order to get the coherent light of out of a diode. So next, coming to the applications of laser diode, so it is used in CD or a DVD writing and reading. So it is used in a CD players. So basically the CD players, so they use the laser technology in order to create what we call it as pits and flats on a surface. So that is used to write the data, the audio data on a surface of a CD with the help of a laser. It is going to, the data is stored in the form of a pits and lags. So that is again makes use of laser light to create the pits and lags. And while reading, that is about the writing. So while reading, again this laser diode, it follows a track over the surface, over the CD surface. So what are the reflected light which is coming from the surface, so they measure the time taken by the laser light to reflect, and they measure the difference in the time taken. Hence we are going to obtain the decoded data with the help of the sensors. So this is how the laser, the lights are used in the CD players for reading and writing of a CD. Then it is used in the communication. That is a meaning here. So this laser light, it acts as a light source for the optical fiber communication. So where with the help of a laser light, it carries a signal through the media. So basically it is a silica fiber through which the laser light is used to carry the signals. Then the third is, it is also used in land mapping. So this basically used to measure the measurement of the distance of a target. So whenever the light is made to fall on the particular target, and it measures what is the time taken for the reflected light to reach a sensor. Then depending on that, so they are going to map a 3D diagram of the areas. So with the help of a laser light, so what we call it as a land mapping. So it makes use of a technology called as LIDAR or a LEDAR. So that is a light amplification by what we call it as similar to a radar. So it makes use of a laser light. So in order to measure the distance to the target. And it is also used in metal cutting and the welding. So for the industrial purposes, so in order for the scribing, IC fabrication techniques where in order to cut the IC into individual chips, wafers into individual chips. So it makes use of the laser beam, and also used in the medical field, in case of surgeries, in order to remove the unwanted tissues or the eye treatment. So in such cases, instead of the surgical knives, so they obtain a better results when it is done with the laser, makes use of a laser. Then also used in anti-missile defenses. So this is generally what we say, it is a laser guided defense missiles. So where this laser light is used to focus the target. So with the help of a laser light, the target is focused with the help of a laser beam, so which is used in a anti-missile defense systems. So these are some of the applications of the laser. So here the diagram shown is the first one is a laser diode. So we see here is through the small opening through which the coherent light is emitted. And the second diagram is shown is a CD player. So with the laser light, you can see, so which helps for CD writing and reading. And we have a laser light, barcode scanner, and this is a laser torch. And we have a tiny laser guided missile, so which helps to focus a target, so which is used in anti-missile systems. So these are some of the applications of laser. Next, coming to the one more device, which is called as maser. So if you compare the laser and maser, so what we see is only the first letter L stands for the light. So which is in the visible range of electromagnetic spectrum of a single wavelength. But in case of your maser, it is a microwave. This maser stands for microwave amplification by stimulated emission of radiation. So whatever the light, which is the radiation emitted by the maser, so which is in the microwave range, which is from 300 gigahertz to 300 megahertz to 300 gigahertz. So this is, it is a device. How do we define a maser? It is a device, so which uses a stimulated emission of radiation. So the working, the operation of the maser and the laser is same. So what is the difference is, whatever the emitted radiation, in case of laser, it comes under the visible range. But here in case of a maser, it is a microwave ray. So this device uses a stimulated emission of a radiation by excited atoms to generate a coherent monochromatic electromagnetic radiation in the microwave region. So as I told, that is between the frequency range of 30 megahertz to 300 megahertz to 300 gigahertz. So that is a major difference between the laser and the maser. So this maser operates according to the same principle as a laser. So the operating principle of a maser and the laser is same. Whatever the radiation it is generating, in case of a maser, it is in the microwave range. Sometimes we see the radiation generated by this maser So radio waves and the UV range. So whatever the diagram shown here is an example for a solid state measure. So we have different types of measure. Under that, the shown here is a solid state measure. So whatever the type of a medium, the stimulated emission or the lasing action medium which is used here is a solid state device. So hence we call that as a solid state measure. So we'll see some of the features of this measure, what we call it as microwave amplification by stimulated emission of radiation. This measure requires basically the devices. One is oscillator and another is a resonator. So this oscillator, which is used to get a excited atoms or in order to take the electrons to the higher energy level, so this oscillator is required. And another device which is required is a resonator. Whatever the radiation which is generated, it has to be stored in a certain cavity, what we call it as resonator or resonator cavity. So this measure requires an oscillator to take the electrons to the higher energy level, or what we call it as to get the excited atoms. So excited atoms is meaning that, so we have the electrons in the higher energy level. The another device which is required is a resonator, so which stores the radiation which is generated when the electrons fall from a higher energy level to a lower energy level. So what is the meaning of this excitation? So this excitation, it basically makes more atoms into the upper energy level. So it takes the electrons to the upper energy level than in the lower energy level in order to get the amplification by stimulated emission to predominate over absorption. So what is absorption is? So because of absorption from the external energy, the electrons will jump to the higher energy band. So what is this excitation is? It takes the atoms or the electrons from the upper energy level. It takes the electrons to the upper energy level so when we achieve the process of amplification by stimulated emission, so when they jump from the excited state to a lower state, so they emit the electromagnetic radiation. So some of the common types of the measures are atomic beam measures, we have gas measures, and we have a solid state measures. So these measures are classified based on the medium which is present in the resonant cavity. So what is that medium? So which is going to give the lasing action, or what we call it as a stimulated emission action. So depending on what medium is giving the stimulated emission action, so depending on that we have atomic beam measure, so which are the ammonia measure and the hydrogen measure. So depending on, so what is the atom or the molecules which are used to take to excite, for the excitation, what type of molecules are excited, so which talks about at the atomic level. So depending on this, we have ammonia measure, so it makes use of ammonia molecules, and we have a hydrogen measure which makes use of a hydrogen atoms to take into a excitation. Then we have the gas measures. Under this, it makes use of a vapor of a rubidium. So hence that is the reason we call it as a, it makes it in the state of gas. Gaseous state is utilized for the lasing action to generate the electromagnetic radiation. And the third, we have a solid state measures. Under that we have a ruby measure. So here it makes use of a ruby crystal, so where it generates a oscillation. So whenever it is excited, it generates a oscillation, so which results in the generation of a electromagnetic radiation. So these are some of the types of measures. So as we told, first the measure which was developed was using a beam of ammonia molecules, so which belongs to a category of atomic beam molecules. And the second was a hydrogen measure, so that makes use of a intrinsic properties of a hydrogen atom. So these atoms or the molecules are taken into the excited. So with certain process, so they gives rise to a stimulated emission. Then the third one was the gas measure, which is a rubidium measure. Here it consists of a microwave cavity, so which is filled with rubidium vapor in the form of a gas state, and a nitrogen gas, so which gives rise to a what we call it as stimulated emission of a radiation. Then the ruby measure, so as I told, so it consists of a ruby crystal which is kept in the resonating cavity. So depending on what type of medium which is giving out the stimulated emission, so depending on that we have a different types of measures. So this modern measures are designed not only generate the electromagnetic waves at a microwave frequency, but we see some of the measures, so but they can generate the electromagnetic radiation even at the radio and the infrared frequency signals. So even we see the radio signals and the infrared, the signals which are generated with the help of this measures. So this is about some of the features of measures. And looking at the applications of measures, it is used as an amplifier and an oscillator, so which is used to get the oscillation for signals at a microwave frequency. Then used in a satellite communication, used in radio telescope, they used in the radar technology. The same way the application how we have described for the laser, the same way we see the measure but generating the electromagnetic radiation at a microwave range. So next, coming to the summary of what we have discussed in under unit 6. So looking at that, so first we have defined what is opto semiconductor device. So it is basically a transducer which can convert the electrical energy to optical or optical to electronic or electrical energy. So in case of your optical to electrical is, so where it detects the illuminated light and converts into equivalent electrical signals. So the example given here is a photodiode and phototransistor. So what are the example for electrical to optical? The LED and the laser diodes are the example for electrical to optical. And so this optoelectronics, it makes use of the three effects which are called as quantum mechanical effect of light. So those are photovoltaic, photo or photoelectric, and the second one is photoconductivity, and the third one is stimulated emission. So we have seen in each one of this opto semiconductor devices, so which of these effects are utilized. So in case of laser diode and the measure, we have seen the stimulated emission is utilized. And a photodiode, we have discussed about some of the opto semiconductor device. So the first device what we have discussed was photodiode. So this photodiode is a type of photo detector, so which can convert the detected light into electrical current. And this diode is always operated in a reverse bias condition for the current to assist. So this light or a photons is used as an external energy to generate the charge carriers in the depletion region. So this, the light which is used as an external energy to generate the charge carriers across the junction, or what we call it as depletion region. And the phototransistor is nothing but a photodiode with amplification. Whatever the light which is illuminated, so which gives rise to a current, converts this illuminated light into equivalent electrical current. But this is amplified by the transistor in case of phototransistor. So hence we say this is a light sensitive transistor. So its working principle is same as that of transistor. So but what is the difference is, there in case of normal BJT, we see that the voltage source is connected at its input. But in case of phototransistor, so the light is used as a input. The base region is made light sensitive, and the same way it has got a three layer. So hence the base region is made light sensitive. So we have seen that a phototransistor is a diode with a photo amplification. So that its working is very much similar to a normal BJT, except that so instead of a light voltage source, we make use of a light source. And whatever the electrons which are generated in the CB junction gives rise to a base current IB, then which is multiplied by the current gain factor, which is called as beta. So hence beta multiplied by the base current IB, which gives rise to the collector current, which is nothing but what we call it as IC, which is the output current from the transistor IC. So hence, so we say that the phototransistor is, we say that a diode with amplification, which is multiplied by the transistor's direct current gain factor, which is beta. So this is about phototransistor. Then we have discussed about LED. So LED stands for light emitting diode. So when we say it is a diode, it is made up of a semiconductor having the PN junction, and it is based on electroluminescence phenomenon, where there is a direct conversion of electrical energy into a light energy. And the whatever the light colors so emitted by a LED are usually orange, red, yellow, or a green. So it depends on what is the type of a semiconductor material it is used and their energy gap between the conduction band and the valence band. And sometimes we see that the light emitted by the LED is a invisible, which we call it as IR LED, which is infrared LED. And we have discussed about opto-isolator. It is also called as opto-coupler. And this is a device. It is a combination of LED and a photodiode. LED is what is a light emitting device, and a photodiode is light sensing device. So hence, we see that opto-isolator, it is a combination of LED and a photodiode as a light sensing device, or sometimes we see phototransistor as a light sensing device, so which senses the light which is emitted by the LED. So what is this device? So this opto-isolator, it is helps to transfer electrical signal. It helps to transfer an electrical signal between two isolated circuits with the help of light. That is how we define a opto-isolator. So what it is, it transfers an electrical signal between two isolated circuits with the help of light. So whatever we see, the LED and the photodiode, so inside the opto-isolator, they are isolated. We don't see any electrical connection between them. So only which is an optical medium, so which is carrying the signal between the two circuits. So this is about opto-isolator, or what we call it as opto-coupler. And these two, the photo emitting, the light emitting device and the light sensitive device, are put it in a enclosed body, or what we call it as packages. So generally we see opto-isolators which are available in the IC packages, so with the external connecting leads. And we have discussed about solar cell, or what we call it as photovoltaic cell. So it is a device which converts the sunlight, the energy from the sunlight, into a electricity, and it works with the photovoltaic effect, where there is a direct conversion of a light into electrical energy. And this conversion, which involves the absorption of a light and then producing a electron hole pairs, and then charge carrier separation. So the working of the solar cell can be always explained with three steps. First is the light energy is absorbed, then it produces an electron hole pairs, and the third step is the generated electron hole pairs are separated, what we call it as charge carrier separation, which gives rise to a current, what we call it as the electrical current through the solar cell. So that was about a solar cell. Whenever this solar cells, so we have got the more number of solar cell, so which are interconnected, and that assembly, what we call it as solar, so panel along with the protective sheet, what we call it as solar panel. And we have discussed about a laser. So this laser stands for light amplification by, what is a phenomenon? Stimulated emission of radiation. So we have a different types of a laser depending on what type of medium it is using, whether it is a solid, gas, liquid, or a semiconductor. So whatever we have discussed is a semiconductor type of a laser, which we call it as laser diode, so which makes use of a PN junction. And this laser diode is very much similar to LED, which is a light emitting diode. So this working of laser diode, it takes place in three steps, mainly energy absorption, spontaneous emission, and a stimulated emission. So in case of LED, we see only this spontaneous emission and the energy absorption. But in case of laser diode, along with these two steps, we have a one more phenomenon called as stimulated emission. So what happens in case of energy absorption? Whenever the diode is forward biased, the electrons start drifting. So while crossing the junction, they recombine, so emitting the photon energy. So hence, they emit a photons, what we call it as spontaneous emission. So energy absorption is they start drifting and they recombine, giving rise to the photons which is emitted from the surface. Then these emitted photons, they strike the excited atoms, giving rise to some more photons, what we call it as amplification of a photons. So what the phenomenon we call it as stimulated emission. So this is about the laser. Then coming to the last device, which is a MASER, so which stands for microwave amplification by stimulated emission of radiation. So if you compare the laser and MASER, the first letter, so light, so which is in the visible range, whatever the electromagnetic radiation, so which is generated is in the visible range, but in case of MASER, it is in the microwave range. The MASER operates with the same principle as we discussed for the laser, but what is the difference is generates a radiation at a microwave range. So this is about the opto semiconductor devices, and so this is the end of today's class. Thank you, one and all. Any questions?